Thank you. Thank you. My name is Chris Yankoff. Thank you all very much for being here. I'm so thrilled and happy that so many of Mike's friends and family are here to show their love and support, especially for his family and all of the awesome personnel that is here from EMS Fire. There are so many awesome people. So thank you all very, very much for being here. At this time, if you could turn off or silence or anything you can do for your cell phones today. I know that some people aren't able to do that are here, and that's okay too. So we have a full house. Every seat is being used, and there are no parking spots for a very long ways away. So Mike would be happy with all this excitement, and we'll have a good parade for him up to the cemetery following our service today. So thank you all very, very much for coming. Pastor Tim Manzer will be leading our service today, so thank you all very much for coming.
I'd like to begin with a prayer. Dear Lord, we ask you to join this time. We're thankful that we saw you in your word walk into a terrible situation and weep with Mary and Martha. So we know that you're weeping with us. But dear Lord, we thank you that we weep with those that have hope. We're hope of glory, hope of your love, forgiveness and grace. Join this time. We ask two things, that you'd be glorified, and we get to tell the story of your son really well, Michael. In your mighty name, amen.
Amen.
We'd like to begin with the song, Shine Your Light. know that each and every one of you could give a tribute, but that would be a bit long. So we have invited people from each phase of Michael's life that he loved and was part of. We begin with Chief Tiller to talk about his love with being a first responder.
Good morning. Thanks to everybody for making a trip out here on a Tuesday morning, beautiful fall morning here, to recognize Mike and his service to the community and also Mike's family. I got asked by Chief Pat Parker to say, hey, you know, they need somebody at Mike's service to talk about some of the things Mike did. We can't talk about here today. And that'll be for later, I'm sure. I had the honor and privilege of working with Mike for many years, especially as a new person with Traverse City Fire. And that's what I'm here to talk about, my experiences with him and others when I first started my career with the Traverse City. Just reviewing though real quick, Mike graduated in 73, Traverse City Central, right? And joined up with Garfield Township, Station 11, which grew into Grand Traverse Metro as a firefighter. I didn't know that. He was a firefighter first. Had I known that, I probably would have tried to recruit him out of my fire department. I didn't know that. But he followed the EMT field. Started in 1973 with the Grand Traverse Ambulance. So 73, I would have been in seventh grade. And that's back when people were wearing bell bottoms and their hair was a little longer and it's god awful disco music. But you know, Mike heard the calling, and you know, EMTs in the field and paramedicine especially was a new thing. They had the emergency show right on TV. When I teach at the fire academy, none of the kids know what that is. I said, Google it on your break, you'll learn some. But that was Mike's calling. He wanted to give back to the community. He was with Grand Traverse Ambulance from 73 to 83. And then there was a 10-year millage that failed. And so that ambulance service went away. Grand Traverse EMS came into play, and then Northlight picked it up in 1984. And so he ran with Northlight for many, many years. And that's where I met Mike first. Since then, he'd worked with Blair Township, Glen Lake, Benzie County. I'm not sure if there's things that I missed in there, but that is, you know, two or three counties worth of Mike spread out over many, many years. 46 years of service to his community, and all those people that he touched and helped, you know, the list, you know, could probably fill up our town here today. Mike was affectionately known as, he had a lot of pet names. We'll talk about a couple of them, a couple we can't talk about, but one of them was a magnet. And if you're in emergency services, whether you're in law enforcement or the fire service or EMS, a magnet, it's kind of a mixed bag. It's actually kind of a term of endearment, but it's also like, hang on, this guy's working today and he's my partner. I learned that I would always carry two or three extra sets of gloves in my pocket and maybe an extra IV bag on ambulance, because when Mike is on, 9 times out of 10, there's gonna be like the call of the month, and you're gonna be right there with him, alongside of him, and you wouldn't want a better partner with you. Mike was rock solid. He was also known as Captain Chaos, and I was given a sticker that's going to go on the side of my command vehicle for quite a while. And another one I heard of from one of my colleagues at the fire department, that after a couple of calls, he had a field grade promotion to major disaster. I thought that was really good, you know. But he all took it in a stride. You know, Mike was a very congenial guy, very happy-go-lucky, liked to have fun, liked to mix it up. My first call that I ran, I didn't run with Mike, that Mike was involved in, that I responded to. I started with the city in April of 1990. And Captain Frank Olson had just taken me down to JCPenney's on Front Street, bought me 3 gray button-up shirts, had the patches sewn on. And this was probably my 3rd or 4th shift on the fire department, still on probation and still learning a lot. And we had a call of a person not breathing. And my partner and I want to say it was Jerry Kolger, saddled up in our little one-ton rescue pickup out of Station 1. And the call was here on the east side of town. And Mike Traylor showed up, and Jeff Shamrell. They were the partners that day. And I had heard from my captain and my lieutenant at the time, who was sitting in the back somewhere. Where are you? Mr. Corey, I know. Mr. Corey, I know you're here somewhere in the building. Anyway, they said, hey, this is how it works. You go to the call, you work with the ambulance company, help them out, and they transport, you do whatever you need to do to help them. I'm like, great. So we get there, and this person is outside and not breathing and needs help right now. And somebody said, hey, get that T-shirt off of him. And so I'm a brand new guy. This is way, I didn't even have a pair of trauma shears. This is way before pocket tools. But being a kid that grew up in the country, you always had a knife on you. And I had a brand new buck knife that my dad had bought me. He says, you might need this in the fire department. I'm like, great, Dad. And the thing's sharp as a razor. So as they're breaking out the medical equipment, getting ready to put the heart monitor cable leads on this person, that's why they needed a shirt off. I pulled the guy's shirt up, and much like skinning a deer, just went vit, about that quick. I'm like, Jesus, put that knife away. And he's like yelling in my ear. And that's the first thing I learned about Mike is he has adrenaline glands the size of a rhino. And it's like a hair trigger. And Jeff's going, all right, you might want to put that away, Mike. So that was, you know, opposites, right? Mike and Jeff, and they worked well together. Mike was one of many Northlight personnel at that time that actually cycled through our number two station over on 8th Street. Worked a 24-hour shift. He had a locker in our station for 15 years. And he was a really good friend of the fire department. He mixed right in, like they all did. We're actually part of the city fire family for a long, long time, which also means that, much like any other emergency service, we only pick on the ones we care about. I might got picked on a little bit, and he always took it in a stride. In fact, there was always he was always willing to help. You know, do the dishes. We can never cook. The ambulance is really busy. Whoever the city fire guy was partnered with, the Northlight person working on the ambulance, we never had time to cook or run so hard. And we'd eat lunch, and Mike would say, I got dishes. And he's doing dishes. And Mike is very focused on whatever he's doing. He's right there in the moment, and he's doing dishes. And there was a certain person that really loved to come up behind him and jump and go, hey, Mikey! And the dishes would hit the sink, and the water would go up, and the water would come down on his shirt, and he goes, I've got more shirts in my locker. It's a station too. I know what's going to happen. You know, and he'd laugh about it, but we'd all be white. You know, what's going to happen? Yeah, like clockwork. But that never got old. But there's a lot of folks cycled through there that were, a lot like Mike. Really good people that took the time. Our medical provision at City Fire, we were EMT basics for many, many years. And then some of us went to specialists. And then in the late 90s, we were being trained as paramedics. And these folks that had all this experience, you know, before I ran into Mike, he had many years on the street. And it's not all about knowing the textbook and knowing the protocols. It's knowing how to deal with people, especially when they're having a super, super bad day, so to speak, right? They're having the worst day of their life. And he's right there, and he's caring, and he's present there, and he's talking with them and calming them down and helping them. And he was really a good role model for that, to learn that from. You know, guys like, you know, Mike and Steve McIntyre, Wayne Merval, Lynette Clute, Gary McGee, Gary Bradley, Sonny Ramirez, Roy Mize, Rick Osborne, all those folks really kind of took care of the city fire folks when we were just learning that next level of paramedicine, which they've been practicing all along. They didn't make a big deal about it. Hey, here it is. This is what we do. And it was very, very helpful. And I always thank those folks, and especially Mike, for that. I remember one time Mike says, you know, I'm not getting enough sleep. We're running hard at night. I need to get some sleep. So he showed up with a sleeping mask. Right? And he says, I'm going to go take a nap. And he went to rack out, and we're like, huh, okay, I guess that'll work. And we had a lieutenant at that time, Mike Brown, who was as much of a trickster as anybody, and he went into the ambulance and got a bottle of activated charcoal. Yeah, and the EMTs in the room know what I'm talking about, where this is going. And this is if somebody eats something that's poison, you get this in them, and then when they throw it up, it actually binds to whatever they ate, and it goes out, and life's better. Well, Mike found that sleeping mask and put that charcoal on that sleeping mask, did tell Mike Traylor. Mike Brown did that. So the next call, like a couple hours later, man, out he comes looking like a big old raccoon, and we didn't say a word. He ran the whole call like that, and the patient's looking at him like, what is going on? And he's like, oh, no, you're going to be fine. You're going to be fine. And we're just dying. It was great. It was great. Mike had a special way of responding in the ambulance. Our job with City Fire was to drive, and we'd help out on a call, but our job was to get there. And a lot of times we were running out the highway out of town, out past the state park up that way to go up into Antrim County or Kalkaska for an intercept, you know, way back before a lot of the agencies provided their own paramedics. And it's cherry festival time, and the traffic is thick, and they're not moving. We got two full lanes ahead of us, two full lanes coming at us. We got all the lights and sirens going. I can't drive any faster, and Mike's getting frustrated. And at that time, they had this ginormous, like, deer shining spotlight hung on a dash, way before LED. So this thing was like this, and you turn it on, and it's like the surface of the sun, right? And he picks it up, and this is like in the afternoon, and he starts wig-wagging it in the windshield. Like this, and what are you doing? So I'm trying to get the traffic out of the way. We gotta get. I'm like, okay, you're kind of pumped up here. Okay, I'll just drive. And then pretty soon I go, Mike, what? And he right in my face with it. I'm like, oh, nice, blind the driver. One eye, oh, what are you? So I say, you hit me right in the face with that light. I put that thing away. Oh, okay. And he got a little excited and he thought he was doing good. And then there was a few of us at City Fire that worked with Mike that are there, and we were sharing stories here last week, and I was apprised of one that I had to put in here, and that was rainy, icy, kind of like the weather we're going to have in about a month, wintertime night, and there was a motor vehicle accident out on Vance Lane and 113 way out east of Kingsley where that big curve is by Fife Lake, and I was not on the rig, but when I heard this story, I remember hearing the traffic. Anyway, EMS-2 goes out of station 2, firefighter and Mike, and they're driving down there because they need a paramedic on the scene. Somebody's hurt. And Mike would always give central updates. I don't know if they assigned a special dispatcher to Mike when he was working, but he was on the radio a lot, a little bit more than me, and always giving updates and be central, be advised. And then everybody, okay, what's coming? And he would say, be advised, the roads are very, holy jumping, and a bunch of stuff I can't really see here. And then Central came back, yeah, copy EMS-2, roads are very slippery. You know, they almost lost it, and he went into a panic, and they recovered and got to the call, and it made things happen. I remember it was back in the mid to late 90s, and Chris and Kara were small, sorry, it was a while ago. My hair was a different color too, but there's an event going on at Mike and Cindy's there in a subdivision over there by Silver Pines, right? That's where you guys live, okay. Walked in there, and I've never been to Mike's house. You know, it's always interesting to be invited to people's houses that you work with because it kind of gives you like a clue to their personality or how they are at work. And I walked into this garage, and it's beautiful. It's immaculate. Not a spot of dirt on the floor. It's clean. Things are put away. It's organized. And I know we all kind of do that, right, when we have people over in company. But he must have spent hours on this. And I was asking, you know, some of the guys he works with, oh, no, it's always like this. You know, Mike is squared away. And I noticed that when he works on an ambulance. Or we wash an ambulance. He says, oh, we're not done yet. And he grabbed a squeegee. We got a squeegee in the ambulance. I'm like, you're kidding me. We're going to go out in the slop here in about 10 minutes on a call. No, squeegee the ambulance. I don't want any watermarks, no streaks, nothing. I'm like, yeah, you're the boss. We'll make it happen. So I'm in his garage, and I'm looking at the washer and dryer, and there's a water heater in the garage. And I'm like, man, those are old, but they look brand new. And yeah, Mike puts car wax on them. I'm like, you're kidding me. Like, I go up there and like, ooh, slippery. I said, Mike, did you act these? Well, yeah, sure. Doesn't everybody? I'm like, no, but that's Mike. You know, that's Mike. And he was also, you know, he got out lucky one time. There's a notebook. I remember a scrapbook at that party, and it was a little binder, and it showed this ambulance accident up on Alden Highway. Did he ever tell you guys about that? A long time ago. Yeah, he and a partner is a Cadillac ambulance, like one of the big long ones, like what you see in Ghostbusters, right? And he and his partner got hit. Somebody ran a sign and got hit. And he was unconscious, and his female partner, go girls, dug him out like a sack of beans and, you know, helped them. And I said, man, you're lucky you're teamed up with a good partner. Yeah, I know. Yeah, we helped each other that night. And so he, you know, He had a couple of near misses here and there. He was also, I remember, on duty with Norfleet, as I was on May 12th, 1998, when Officer Dennis Finch got shot just over here in Boardman neighborhood. He was on that call. I was sitting in an ambulance with him, and we'd been called there that morning, or actually, I think about midday, for a standby, and then we learned what was going on, and we were all kind of milling about in the background while the, you know, police are doing their thing. And he's sitting in the driver's seat of the rig. I'm not even assigned. I'm on an engine that day. And I'm just sitting there chatting because we're friends, you know. And we're just trying to talk each other out of the super stressful situation going on. And then I started to hear gunshots. And I lost count after 23, 24. And Mike goes, "Those are gunshots." Boom, in drive and hammer down. And we're going in. I'm like, "Whoa, Mike, stop. Stop. We need to get there." I'm like, "Mike, it's not safe. Back up." Okay, you know, but that was Mike. He's going to be there when he needs to be there, and regardless of his own safety. And, you know, I'm glad I was able to stop him. I was almost ready to jump on him because that was an uncontrolled scene, and we don't need to be in there. But that's Mike. That's what he's thinking about. That's how focused he was. I heard another comment from one of the folks that worked with Mike, and it said, "Mike cared enough for three people. Cared all the time. I never seen Mike get upset." Now, emergency services can be very, very frustrating, very, very difficult. I've never seen him get upset. He'd get pretty intense sometimes and say, "I need to talk to you." No, no, no. Okay, that's different than losing your cool and throwing stuff against the wall. I've never seen him do that. He's a real good medic. I know. I always breathed easier when I was his partner and he was my partner. Yeah, he's a really good guy. Proud to have worked with him, and I'm really going to miss him. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Another person that can represent part of what Michael loved is Michelle, if you could come up and speak.
Hi, my name is Michelle, and this is my business partner, Jessica, and we own a wine tour company here in town that Mike drove for. So we're from his next part of his life, where he came into our life about three seasons ago. Sorry, I'm a crier. And he did so much good. He got great reviews. People loved him. He, in this job, took care of people also. He was highly requested. He was super reliable. I think he just said when Mike was supposed to be there, he was there. And he was. And he took care. He did care enough for three people. We feel very honored to have had him as part of our family. We have a huge hole right now that, as does everyone else, but we want to thank him. Thank you, Mike, for being you. You were so amazingly awesome and will be sorely missed in our company. And the irony of him being a designated driver and being hit by a drunk driver is something that we don't really want to talk about, but everyone needs to keep it in their mind, right? We all need to move forward and remember Mike and never get in a car. Right? Call someone. Just don't do it. It hurts too much. Jess?
I was this morning up at about 4 o'clock this morning, and for myself, a song is something that always, I look for one to tell me how I'm feeling, tell me how I should be feeling. And the song for myself this morning was one by John Mayer, and he says, "Bad news never has good timing." And this was probably the worst timing it could have possibly been, him coming home from work, driving a group of people who had a great day, who's heading home to see his family and to enjoy his weekend. But the song goes on to say, "Your friends will gather around in a circle and they'll defend the silver lining. And for us today, we have to remember that the silver lining is that we got the time, we got 66 years to spend with him. Of all the infinite number of people we could have run into in our lives, we got to be with Mike Traylor. Yeah. We got to enjoy that time with him. So we remember that whenever, the word whenever, could automatically be changed to never that quickly. I'll talk to him whenever I get a chance. Quickly turned into, I will never get the chance to speak to him again. So let's all be reminded in that silver lining that we still have time, because that's the only gift that we have in this life. And so remember that silver lining. Use the time that we have, because none of us know when our time is up. So remember that and let it be the silver lining for us all. And let's remember this life that connected all of us. And I bet you if you looked in here, you didn't realize you knew Mike Traylor. Oh wait, I didn't realize you knew Mike Traylor too, because he had such a vast touch in this community. And so remember that you've been connected by this man here. And so carry it on. We will carry on his memory too. Thank you.
And I'd like to invite Kara and Kevin up to represent his ultimate love, his family.
For anyone that might not know me, my name is Kevin York, and I'm Mike's son-in-law. My family genuinely appreciates you coming here today to help us give Mike the send-off he deserves. On June 28th, 2008, Mike walked my beautiful wife, Kara, down the aisle to me at our wedding. Little did he know that a little over 1 year later, we would end up buying a house about six houses down the road from him. Before buying the house, I lived in apartments, and Kara probably married the least handy person she probably could have married, to be completely honest. I think you know where I'm going with this. Six houses up the road, son-in-law that can't fix much of anything. Mike was about to get an awful lot of phone calls. And I have no idea over the approximately 8 years that he lived up the road from me how many times I called him to fix something. Let's just say it was often. During each fix, Mike always made plenty of Mike-style witty jokes, and I think everybody in the room who know Mike knows exactly what I'm talking about. You're like, that's funny. There's a lot of those during our fixes. And he was incredibly helpful in teaching me what to do. And as we've heard today, Mike took a great deal of pride in what he did, and I take a great deal of pride in my home as a result of the things that he helped me with in the house. And I'm not sure how many folks in attendance spend countless hours maintaining their lawn. But this is one thing I always admired about Mike's house. Anybody who'd ever, driven by the lawn of Mike would know that it was beautiful, lush, green, and absolutely perfectly mowed. And I mean perfectly mowed. And if you knew, as we've heard, Mike took pride in keeping things extremely clean and looking very, very good. Kara has told me many stories over the years about her life. And I strive year after year living down the road from Mike to have that beautiful green lawn. When I moved in, I had lots of weeds in my lawn, and it was an absolute mess. And over the years, I always strive to have the best weed-free lawn like Mike. In 2017, when he sold his house and moved, I finally thought, maybe I've got the chance to have the best lawn in the neighborhood. This might be my chance. Kara has told me stories about her dad growing up where he would go out in the lawn with some scissors and try to even some things out with the lawn. It was about a month ago. I showed Mike a little tool that he didn't know about, and I was so proud of this because I said, Mike, you got to know this. There's this this non-toxic spray that you can spray on your lawn, so when it gets yellow, you just spray it on the lawn, and it's green. You're good to go. Like, you don't have to worry about that little yellow spot in your lawn anymore. And I can only imagine if that would have been available many years ago, how much of that he would have had in his garage. Because let me tell you, I could see him going around the lawn with his scissors and his spray. Mike, you're a hero that will always, always put the needs of others first. As a grandparent, a father-in-law, a dad, a friend, an uncle, a brother, paramedic, cab driver, designated driver, and all the other hats that you wore, you will be sincerely missed. Mike, I promise to forever take care of Kara and make you proud up there in heaven.
First of all, I just want to thank everybody for coming here today and supporting our family. I don't think you can understand how much it means to us during this time. People say that to say it to be polite, but I truly mean it. Never would I have thought this is how we are remembering my dad. He was truly one of a kind. I mean, really, how many Captain Chaoses do you know? That term is used lovingly for anybody that doesn't know. I've always been told that there was always some sort of chaos when my dad was around, and I believe it. I've always been told that when he was around, people felt comfort, calm, and loved. He had such a unique personality, and it was really quite entertaining. My dad cared for so many people throughout his life, and he took so much pride in that. He loved being part of the family business, working as a paramedic, and his most recent adventure driving for designated driver TC and Grand Traverse Distribution. My dad took so much pride in the job of being a paramedic. He loved taking care of people. It takes a certain kind of person to do that job, and my hat's off to him and anybody else. He posted so many pictures of fun cars he was able to drive when he was a designated driver. It was always funny getting into Facebook and seeing a picture of somebody else's car and him standing by with a cheesy grin. The way he went is not fair. He spent a majority of his life getting people to their destination safely, and that's all that I could have wished for him. I'm going to miss my dad so much for so many reasons, but what I'll miss the most is him watching my kids grow up. I know he was proud of all of his grandchildren. I believe my dad's last hero act was saving the couple in front of him that night. I feel like the world just got a little scarier without Mikey. Rest easy, Dad. We love you. I also have a short clip from my daughters who wanted to say a couple words, so I'm just gonna play that right now. I have my phone on silent though, so.
He would take us to a favorite spot of ours in the summer.
The splash pad.
He was fun to be around and would stop by most Sundays to check in. I'll always remember how wonderful he was.
My papa was so special and important to me.
My papa was so inspirational as a paramedic, saving and helping so many lives. We will miss our papa, and he'll always be in our hearts.
We have the song Dancing in the Sky.
Shining bright forever. Have
we weep. But today we celebrate Michael Traylor. I called first responders that I knew, and the first one I talked to immediately said, "Oh, you mean Captain Chaos." And that's before I knew his nickname. I said, I think that's who I'm talking about. And Captain Chaos. Mike may have been called that, but his lifestyle wasn't chaos. He was neat and orderly. His lawn was, as mentioned, always perfectly cared for, green, beautiful, and perfectly groomed. His 45 years of emergency care always found him prepared and ready. Plan for what is difficult while it is easy. Do what is great while it is small. Sun Tzu, The Art of War. Other first responders said this to me about Mikey. They knew that every time he arrived, everything was going to be okay. One of the men I talked to said peace was there when he was there. Another said Mike knew what to do. Captain Chaos knew what had to happen and the steps to make it happen when he was on the scene. Michael loved his family. His grandkids were a huge joy to him. He looked forward to all family outings, family reunions. Mike was there. Birthday, he is coming. And then I heard stories about your childhood in the pop-up camper and camping from place to place, the joy of gathering family together. That was his greatest love. I also must mention that he was part of the designated Grand Traverse group here. And why? Why would he do that? After he retired, because he cared, and he wanted no more senseless injury and death on our roads. And I pray as a minister, this is the last funeral I do like this. In this gathering, I want to thank you as well, the first responders, and Mike is a representative of you. In the past, I served as a hospital chaplain, a volunteer fireman for the Spring Arbor Fire Department near Jackson, Michigan, and for the last 21 years as a care pastor at New Hope Community Church. And I continue to care for the immediate needs of my church and community. But I've also been rescued. 19 years ago, I was returning from a wedding rehearsal on my motorcycle. My mama said, when she saw my motorcycle show up as a young guy, "You're gonna break every bone in your body and kill yourself." But all I did was break every bone in my body. On that day, I was accidentally hit by a car that ran a stop sign. That girl was in an argument on her cell phone. Everything changed in a moment. An instructor on his way to teach a class at the Thompsonville Volunteer Fire Department watched the accident and immediately responded. I don't know who that was, but thank you, prepared stranger, who saved my life. To all of you, I say, please keep preparing. NorFlight airlifted me to ER. Years of surgeries, physical therapy, and occupational therapy followed. But here I stand celebrating Captain Chaos, Mike, Michael Traylor, and all of you who respond. In the Bible is the story of the Good Samaritan. It's a story where the priest, the pastor, myself, gets to play the part of the bad guy because he doesn't stop. The Samaritan, the outcast, gets to play the good part. He spends his time, energy, and resources to save the life of a man who had been beaten by thieves and left to die. Thank you all. Thank you, Michael, for spending your time, your energy, and your resources to respond at very difficult times and in very difficult circumstances. The Good Samaritan is a picture of Jesus as well. Each of us needed to be rescued from spiritual doom. The author of Romans says, "What a wretched man that I am. Who will rescue me from the body of death?" Have you ever been like that when you need a soul first responder? The answer is, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus was the first responder in the Bible who dropped everything and ran to earth to rescue lost humanity. We call it Christmas. An instructor was on his way to teach a class to volunteer firemen, and he watched my accident. He dropped everything. His class, his time, and his skills allowed him to rescue me. He was prepared. Jesus was prepared when he arrived on Christmas to rescue all of us. My favorite verse is, "For he, Jesus, has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his Son. He loves in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." Thank you, first responders. Thank you, Michael Treller. And all of you who are willing to respond instead of panic. And thank you, Jesus, the ultimate first responder, who gives us hope in eternity. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we come this day praying, weeping, laughing, telling stories, remembering a life well lived. And dear Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that you taught us so much, but you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Dear God, as we leave this place, may we be better people because we knew Michael Treller, or we heard his incredible story. In your name, amen. There's three events yet to come. The last call, a video that you want to stay for, and you will be dismissed according to a certain order at the very end.
All units stand by for final call for paramedic Mike Treller. Grand Traverse Central Dispatch to Mike Treller. Grand Traverse Central Dispatch to Mike Treller. This is Grand Traverse Central Dispatch to Mike Treller. Central Dispatch to all units. This is the final call for Mike Treller. Mike served the citizens of Grand Traverse County Region as a paramedic since 1973. He did so with honesty, integrity, and of course, a sense of humor. Mike, your service and dedication to this community will not be forgotten, and you will be missed dearly. Grand Traverse Central Dispatch to Mike Treller. We show you out of service, sir. May you rest in peace. Grand Traverse Central Dispatch is clear. November 2nd, 2021.
Special. So this time, if I can have all the uniformed personnel be released first to be able to go outside and greet us.
That'd be you. Good job.